Yeah, welcome back to our YouTube channel where we educate and empower people with information. So do not leave behind your friends, you know, share with them. Also like and subscribe for those who have not subscribed. Today I want us to look at deep venous thrombosis, also called as DVT. Some call it DVTE, for E for thromboembolism. This is a common condition in our people whereby they come with a swollen feet or limb. Sometimes it is associated with pain, you know, change of color or discoloration. For those who are fair skinned, it's easy to see the difference, and tenderness. But occasionally a patient may not have the presentations I just mentioned, but they come because they are not able to breathe well, they are in respiratory distress, and this is a complication of DVT, where they develop deep venous thromboembolism, DVTE. Here now the patient has a complication, the clot has reached the lungs and the patient is not able to breathe well, and the physician or the doctor has now to work backwards to find out the cause of the embolism, and it leads him or her to deep venous thrombosis. This problem is common in the population, but there are more women who present with it than men, and it could be, being female is a risk factor, but when I look at it keenly, I think pregnancy is a risk of its own, and pregnancy only occurs in women. Also women, even the non-pregnant ones, use COCs, that is combined oral contraceptives. They also increase the risk of deep venous thrombosis. So being female is a risk, and pregnancy and use of oral contraceptives is also a risk. Other risk factors that may lead someone into developing deep venous thrombosis include one, hypercoagulate state. You know, some people are born naturally with tendencies of clotting or forming clots in the body, like those ones who have factor V latent. Also protein S and C deficiencies can also lead to hypercoagulate state. People who are immobilized, you know, who do not move around often, maybe they are confined in a bed due to illness, long debilitating illness. It could be spine injury, it could be a fracture or orthopedic issues where patients are not being moved around, or they are on traction. Those ones increase the risk for deep venous thrombosis. Patients or people may be traveling long distances. It could be a driver who seated in the same position for long without stopping, maybe from Mombasa to Congo, or one is a passenger on a flight, you know, flying from somewhere in Africa to London, you know. So those ones also increase the risk for deep venous thrombosis. Injuries, any injury to the body may also increase the risk of deep venous thrombosis. So all these things, you know, they are rolled up into something which is called as the virtuous triad, you know, the three arms. It can be either hypercoagulate state or stasis. It can be immobilization, or it can be endothelial damage. So these three, when they occur in a patient, then he or she is at risk of developing deep venous thrombosis. So all the risk factors, they are rolled into virtuous triad. On the signs and symptoms, we already mentioned that patients can have swelling around the affected area. It is common in the lower limb, it is common in the proximal part, you know, at the calf of the muscles, the gastrocnemius. in the popliteal area. It can also occur in the thigh or in the pelvis. So we can have the iliofemoral or femoral popliteal areas which are affected, but they can occur anywhere else. So patients, you know, who may have the deep venous thrombosis occurring on the lower limb, they may present with what we said, including pain, swelling, change of color or discoloration, tenderness. Some may not want to use the limb. Occasionally, patients may come with respiratory distress or inability to breathe well or be labored breathing because of the complication of deep venous thrombosis. For the very first time, they come unable to breathe suddenly. And when you think and work backwards, then you find that it leads you to DVT. Now, once the patient has developed DVT or you suspect DVT, you need to investigate that patient, confirm the diagnosis, and then to manage or treat that problem. The aim of managing the problem is, one, to reduce the associated mortality. You know, patients die, up to 40% of those who develop deep venous thrombosis. They end up with thromboembolism, and that can kill. To reduce morbidity, you know, the pain, you know, the sickness that is associated with deep venous thrombosis. And also what is called as the PTS, that is to prevent post-thromboembolic syndrome. You know, some patients, after they have developed DVT, they get treated. 2 years down the line, they still have swelling and pain in the leg that was affected. And that is called as a PTS, post-thromboembolic syndrome. Now, we start with the investigation. If the patient came to you or presented to the facility with inability to breathe and you suspect he could be having deep venous thrombosis, which the thrombus has detached and gone to the lungs, you work backwards, and here you look for the D timers. Now, those ones would help you to know. Then we need to know the hypercoagulate state of the patient, whereby you will do the prothrombin time and then activated thromboblastin time. Then you can also do, for the lower limb, you can do Doppler ultrasound, or some call it duplex ultrasound. That will help to locate the site of the thrombus. You know, it will even show occlusion, you know, and non-perfusion of the peripheral tissues. So Doppler ultrasound. Of course, you need the baseline investigations to help you, because sometimes these patients become surgical patients, and for surgical patients, you need the minimum parameters in investigations, like HB, it has to be more than 10 before you take the patient in. Platelets, you have to check through the full hemogram. You need to check the platelets, and they should not be below 100. And then, you know, after you have been investigated, you need to follow up this patient before you start treatment. And if it is the lower limb which is affected and it is around the calf area, you will mark, you know, a specific anatomical site from which you will be making references as you go forward following up that patient. So, for example, you mark the tibial tuberosity, you measure around 5 centimeters down, or even 10. So me, I would prefer use of 5 centimeters from the tibial tuberosity downward. Then you measure the circumference. We are going to be recording that daily to know whether the patient is improving or not. So we use the tape measure, you know, this one from the tailor. You know, yeah. Now, once you have confirmed the diagnosis, then you need to manage this patient. patient, and the management includes admission. You need to admit this patient for close monitoring. Sometimes some people may want to go away, and the problem is follow-up becomes a problem, and some are lost for follow-up. So the best way is you admit them. And you must admit all patients who may have comorbidities, like diabetes, heart failure, kidney failure, and other problems. So those who may not be able to follow instructions also need to be admitted. And this includes children or alcoholics, or people may be mentally disturbed or have some mental disorders, you know, depression, bipolar, and all those. And then geographically, those who come from far places, far-flung areas, you know, you are based here, the patient has struggled to come, and once he gets here, you should not just give medication and they go away. They should stay here. You manage them until when you think the problem is resolving. So people may take 2 days to travel to the hospital, or even two. You know, those ones come from far-flung areas, so they should be admitted. Those ones, the street people, let me not call them children, street people, you know, there could be grown-ups, men or women, who do not have homes where they live. If they come to the hospital and they also have suspected DVT, maybe the one you've confirmed, they should also be admitted. Yeah, so once you have admitted them, you start them on anticoagulation. Anticoagulations are many. We prefer you start the patient off with heparin. Heparin, where you are using 15 international units, subcute, twice a day. You overlap that with coumarin or warfarin. Now, warfarin, you start off with 5 milligrams PO or D for at least 5 days. Now, you are overlapping heparin together with the warfarin for at least 5 days, so that on the 5th day, well, actually, by the 5th day, that is when you start seeing the therapeutic effects of warfarin. So, before it takes off, then you cover the patient with heparin. So this patient should be given that until the INR, international normalized ratio, has reached 2 or above. But many specialists would recommend until when it is 2.5, the index INR 2.5. So then now you can withdraw the heparin and the patient continues with the warfarin. So you'll be checking the warfarin more often for you to be able to control the dosage. The administration should continue for at least 6 months. You know, for those who have had acute deep venous thrombosis, their treatment should not stop after 2 weeks. It should go up to 3 to 6 weeks, and I recommend 6 weeks because it's better you continue giving medication and sustain the patient there than stopping it early and then the patient develops a recurrence. For those who may have a recurrence or who may develop another clot while they are on treatment, then you continue the treatment up to 1 year, that is 12 months. For those who again develops another recurrence or they continue developing many clots, those ones will be given these anticoagulants for life. Of course, you know, for life means a lot. You know, there are risks which are involved or complications. But then, patients who may have, for example, head injury, they have undergone some major surgery. They have been operated on the eye, yeah. They have malignant hypertension, they are pregnant, you know. These patients should not be put on anticoagulants because it would exacerbate, you know, or lead to devastating hemorrhage, which may also kill the patient. You see, the reason why we are giving this medication is to prevent the clot from going to the lungs and therefore killing the patient. So we should not kill the patient in the attempt of saving them. Yeah, so other options we have that you can use, like low molecular heparin, where you can use a subcutaneous route that the dosage is lower, like you use 40 milligrams or in international units, where you keep subcutaneous BD or twice a day. So you can do so where the patient is with you, and as the signs and symptoms reduce, or as the patient gets better, then you can convert to oral. Nowadays, we have rivaroxaban. Rivaroxaban is that is a factor 8 activated inhibitor. Yeah, so you give orally. So a patient can take 20 milligrams of rivaroxaban, and you can send them home that way. Now, rivaroxaban does not need close monitoring like with warfarin or use of heparin. You see, warfarin you need to do INR, you know, every time and again to be sure that it is within normal so that the patient doesn't bleed. And then for heparin you need to do APTT, that is activated partial prothrombin time. So rivaroxaban does not need those things, does not need storage, like you tell the patient to put it in special conditions. So it is a good drug when you are discharging your patient to go home. Like you've seen, this treatment needs long periods for it to resolve. So the patient does not need to live in the hospital where they need to be injected. So oral medication and use of rivaroxaban is very good. It gives a patient chance to return home to his or her activities. Sometimes you may need to resort to use of surgery, like a thrombectomy, you know, where you cut the vessel, involved vessel, and you remove the clot or the thrombus. So it's also called as thrombectomy. And also sometimes subcutaneous dissolution or thrombolysis or use of catheter, you know, where you insert the catheter to where the clot is or thrombus is in an attempt to break it and removing it. So these ones are reserved for patients who may not be candidates for systemic anticoagulants. And we have mentioned them, those people who have uncontrolled hypertension or very elevated hypertension, those who have been operated on the eye, those ones who have had major surgery recently, yeah, or have had bleeding into the brain, like in stroke. So such patients, and even the pregnant ones, such patients need to go straight to use of thrombectomy, use of catheters, subcutaneous thrombolysis, or even use of inferior vena cava filters. Then also patients who may have a chronic or recurrent formation of thrombus would benefit from use of the inferior vena cava filters. Now, these filters do very well for the clots which are equal or more than 4 millimeters. The smaller ones, you don't need to use a filter. So, the management of a deep venous thrombosis may not involve only one specialist or doctor. There may be a need for the hematologist, vascular surgeon, and also radiologist, preferably interventional radiologist, to be brought on board so that we work as a team for us to benefit the patient. Otherwise, it's not easy to manage these problems. So I recommend teamwork so that we help the patient.